dear doctors, let me discuss a very important topic, that is the pneumothorax. Remember, pneumothorax is the clinical condition which is characterized by excessive accumulation of air within the pleural space. That is what is called as the pneumothorax. And the hallmark of this particular pneumothorax is the presence of the collapsed lung. Right? The hallmark of the pneumothorax is the collapsed lung. And remember, this particular pneumothorax is a medical emergency where the individual will have a sudden onset dyspnea, right? And this particular sudden onset dyspnea will be relieved until unless the air which is present within the pleural space is aspirated. Then only the lung will expand, then only the individual's difficulty in breathing or dyspnea will be reduced. Is that clear? So now let me start up, or let me take the discussion of the pneumothorax. So if you see this pneumothorax, remember, pneumothorax is the clinical condition which is characterized by excess amount of air which is present in between, right, which is present in between the parietal pleura and as well as the visceral pleura. So if you take this pneumothorax, is a clinical condition which is characterized by, right, which is characterized by excessive accumulation of air in between the parietal pleura and as well as the visceral pleura, right? And normally if you take the intrapleural pressure, right, if you take the intrapleural pressure, it is negative, right? So a point what you should understand here is, in a normal human being, the intrapleural pressure is negative. Only and only when the intrapleural pressure is negative, then the lungs will expand, right? So we are able to take the atmospheric air into the alveoli because of the presence of the negative intrapleural pressure. But what will happen in these patients with the pneumothorax is, there is excessive accumulation of air within the pleural space, and that negative intrapleural pressure will be replaced either by zero or a positive pleural pressure, right? So once there is a positive pleural pressure, the lungs will not expand, and that will result in the collapse of the lung, right? That will result in the collapse of the lung. So remember, the collapse of the lung is the hallmark in patients with the pneumothorax. Now, so this is the collapsed lung, which is then hallmark feature of your pneumothorax. So now you see here, let me discuss the etiology of the pneumothorax. Right? So the question is like this. Pneumothorax is seen in all except. The options are Marfan syndrome, assisted ventilation, eosinophilic granuloma, and bronchopulmonary aspergillosis. So remember, what are the various headings under which I'll be discussing pneumothoraxes? I have just given you a basic definition, or what do you mean by pneumothorax, I have said you. Later on, I will discuss the etiology of the pneumothorax, and following which, I'll be discussing what will be the clinical features and the examination findings in a patient with the pneumothorax, and following which I'll be discussing how do you diagnose a patient of the pneumothorax and how do you treat a patient of pneumothorax. So under this particular following headings, I'll be discussing this topic of pneumothorax. Now, so the question is, pneumothorax is seen in all except Marfan syndrome, assisted ventilation, eosinophilic granuloma, and bronchopulmonary aspergillosis. So which clinical condition you don't have the pneumothorax is the question. Now, what I'll do is, we can classify the etiology of the pneumothorax into two types. One is traumatic pneumothorax and the other one is spontaneous pneumothorax. And later on, I'll just club up all the etiologies of the pneumothorax. So just listen to me about the etiology. So if you see the pneumothorax, this particular etiology of pneumothorax, right, this particular etiology of the pneumothorax, we can classify this into what is called as traumatic pneumothorax, and the other one is the spontaneous pneumothorax. Right, the other one is the spontaneous pneumothorax. Now, you take the etiology of the traumatic pneumothorax. So, remember, traumatic pneumothorax is the one which is non-spontaneous. Right? Which is non-spontaneous. Alright? So, if you take the etiology of the traumatic pneumothorax, number one, whenever there is a blunt trauma over the chest, right? So, the two individuals, they had a quite quarrel, and in this particular course of the quarrel or fighting, an individual has hit the opposite person, has given a blow over the chest, right? So, that will result in what is called as blunt trauma, right? So, there they will have a fractured rib, and the fractured rib can rupture the pleura, and the individual can have the traumatic pneumothorax, right? The other clinical condition you take, not only blunt trauma, even the penetrating trauma. So, particularly any trauma of the chest, right, where there is injury or the lung parenchyma or the thoracic cage can cause pneumothorax. Next is the iatrogenic, right? This is one of the very important thing. Iatrogenic is the one which is induced by the healthcare individual, right? Either you take the doctor or you take the nursing staff or any healthcare individual inducing the disease in the patient or in the individual is called as the iatrogenic. So, you take the iatrogenic. So, what all iatrogenic conditions can cause pneumothoraxes? For example, you take thoracocentesis, right? The individual is asked to take out the pleural fluid, right? While taking out the pleural fluid, accidentally he has injected the air into the pleural space. That will result in what is called as pneumothorax. So, iatrogenic conditions include number one, thoracocentesis. Alright, next to the thoracocentesis, the other condition is the insertion of the central venous catheter, right? So, you are putting a central line into the jugular vein and accidentally you have punctured the apical part of the pleura. So, that can result in what is called as a iatrogenic cause of the traumatic pneumothorax. Next. The patient is on mechanical ventilator, right? And the settings are little abnormal, right? So, that has caused the rupture of the alveoli and that will result in what is called as pleura. So, those individuals on assisted ventilation can cause the pneumothorax, okay? So, these are all your traumatic, which are non-spontaneous. Now, you take the spontaneous one. The spontaneous one, again we can classify them into a primary spontaneous and as well as the secondary spontaneous. Now, what is the difference between these two, primary spontaneous and as well as the secondary spontaneous? Remember, you take in case of primary spontaneous. In case of primary spontaneous, there is no clinical evidence of the underlying lung disease. Right, there is no clinical evidence of underlying lung disease. Right, there is no evidence of the underlying lung disease. Okay, in case of primary spontaneous pneumothorax. Right, and most of these patients, they are males. Right. And that too, they are tall individuals and thin individuals, and predominantly they are smokers, right? Smokers, and sometimes there can be even a presence of a subpleural blebs, right? Subpleural blebs. So, if they rupture, they can result in pneumothorax. So, there is no clinical evidence of the underlying lung disease. Right, and there is no precipitating factor also in these particular patients of the primary spontaneous pneumothorax. So, they are most commonly seen in case of tall, thin male smokers, and sometimes even they can have the presence of the subpleural blebs. Next, you take the secondary pneumothorax. Secondary pneumothorax, it occurs in persons with an underlying lung disease, right, with an underlying lung disease. Okay,
Now, what I will do is, I'll just discuss the entire etiologies of the pneumothorax. So basically, we have classified the etiology into the traumatic and as well as spontaneous. And spontaneous, again, we have classified this into primary spontaneous and as well as the secondary spontaneous. So what I'll do is, I'll just club up the etiologies of primary spontaneous, secondary spontaneous, traumatic, and as well as some of the miscellaneous causes as well. So now all these etiologies can be remembered in the form of a mnemonic, that is A, B, C, D, E, F, G, H, I. Okay. So the mnemonic for the various etiologies of the pneumothorax is A, B, C, D, E, F, G, H, I. Okay. Now let me take up the individual one. You take the word A. This stands for abscess. And what abscess is this? This is your lung abscess. So lung abscess can rupture and the individual can land up in pneumothorax. And you take the word B. B stands for the bacterial pneumonia. Right? B stands for the bacterial pneumonia. Or even the individuals with necrotizing pneumonia. Right, the individuals with necrotizing pneumonia. There also they can have the pneumothorax. Next, you take the word C. The word C stands for COPD. Mainly, you take in COPD the patients who are having emphysema or emphysematous bulla. Right, they can rupture and the individual can have the pneumothorax. And the patients with the cystic fibrosis. And the patients with the cancer, that is malignancy, and the patients with the congenital cyst. Right, the patients with the congenital cyst. So these are the clinical conditions where you can have the pneumothorax. Next, the word D stands for draining. So what draining is that? So remember, it is the draining of the pleural fluid. So that is nothing but your thoracosynthesis. Right. So the word D, it is draining, that is thoracosynthesis. Right. And you take the word E. The word E stands for the esophageal rupture or endometriosis. So esophageal rupture can cause pneumothorax. Or even you take the endometriosis. Now, what do you mean by this word endometriosis? Remember, endometriosis is that clinical condition which is being characterized by the presence of the endometrium out of the uterus, right? The endometrium normally it should be present within the uterus. And if the endometrium is present outside the uterus, that is called as endometriosis. Now you take in patients with the pulmonary endometriosis. What will happen is the endometrium is present within the lung or in the lung parenchyma or within the pleura. So whenever the individual menstruates, right, whenever the female menstruates, the female will be developing that particular pneumothorax. And that is what is called as catamenial pneumothorax. Right, that is what is called as the catamenial pneumothorax. So the patients with the pulmonary endometriosis, they develop what is called as, right, they develop what is called as the catamenial pneumothorax. Next, next to the E, you take the word F, that is the fractured ribs. Right, the fractured ribs. And you take the word G. G stands for the gunshot injuries. Right, the gunshot injuries or even the knife injuries can cause the pneumothorax. Next, you take the word H. The word H stands for HIV. Remember, as such, HIV will cause pneumothorax, but the opportunistic infection like what you get in HIV, that is pneumocystis jeroesi pneumonia, the individual can have the development of this particular pneumothorax. So, pneumocystis jeroesi pneumonia. Next, lastly, you take the word I. The word I stands for the iatrogenic. So, iatrogenic already we have discussed, that is thoracosynthesis, right? Or the insertion of the central venous catheter, right? Or In patient who is on the assisted ventilation, they can all develop this particular iatrogenic, which is a cause for the pneumothorax. Next, regarding the A, you remember one more thing where the individual can have the development of pneumothorax. We have one of the connective tissue disorder, that is ankylosing spondylitis. This particular group of individuals, they can have this pneumothorax. And not only that, you take the other important connective tissue disorder, which is a disorder which is related to the collagen disease, right? You take the word C, you remember the collagen diseases which can cause the pneumothorax. And what is that particular collagen disease is? Remember the Marfan syndrome. So Marfan syndrome, they will have the development of pneumothorax. And you take the other C, that is connective tissue disorder. The other connective tissue disorder that is also related to the involvement of the joints, that is even your rheumatoid arthritis. So rheumatoid arthritis also, there can be development of your pneumothorax. And the other collagen or connective tissue disorder is the Ehlers-Danlos syndrome, EDS. So remember, ankylosing spondylitis, rheumatoid arthritis, Ehlers-Danlos syndrome and Marfan syndrome. So all these clinical conditions, you have what is called as the development of the pneumothorax, right? And apart from this, you take certain vasculitis, right? Certain vasculitis where you can have the development of pneumothorax is like Wegener's granulomatosis. So remember, in case of Wegener's granulomatosis, there can be development of this particular pneumothorax. Next, we have the disorders, the other thing which is related to the E. The word E, endometriosis, already we have discussed, and you add one more E, that is eosinophilic granuloma. Right, eosinophilic granuloma. So these are all the conditions where you have or where you can come across the pneumothorax. So the entire etiology, you can just remember in the form of a mnemonic: A, B, C, D, E, F, G, H, I. Now, after having discussing the etiology, now we will move back to this particular question. So if you see this question here, pneumothorax is seen in all except Marfan syndrome. I have said you the connective tissue disorder where the individual will have the pneumothorax. And later on, you take the assisted ventilation, right? We have discussed that this is one of the iatrogenic conditions where the individual can have pneumothorax. And later on, you take the eosinophilic granuloma. Also, we have discussed that the individual will have the pneumothorax. And where you don't have pneumothorax is in case of bronchopulmonary aspergillosis, you will not have pneumothorax. All right, next. Now, you see one more question on the pneumothorax. Yes. Now, while inserting a central venous catheter, the patient develops respiratory distress. What would be the most common cause? So definitely, the central venous catheter insertion can cause the injury to the apical pleura, where once the individual has the injury to the apical pleura, the individual can have pneumothorax. So that is the reason why the individual have the respiratory distress. Now, what you have to remember here at this particular question here is, what are all the clinical conditions where you have sudden onset dyspnea? Right? What are all the clinical conditions where you have the sudden onset dyspnea? Remember, this particular sudden onset dyspnea, you come across in the following clinical conditions. Number one will be your pneumothorax. Right? Next, the other condition is in case of pulmonary embolism. Right, the other condition is in case of pulmonary embolism. Next, the other condition where you have like foreign body aspiration. Right, the other condition like the foreign body aspiration. Next, the other clinical conditions like acute exacerbation of COPD or acute exacerbation of bronchial asthma. Right, acute exacerbation of COPD or acute exacerbation of the bronchial asthma, there the individual can have the sudden onset dyspnea. Next, the other conditions where you have the sudden onset dyspnea is in case of the pulmonary edema. So left ventricular failure leading to pulmonary edema, there the individual can have a sudden onset dyspnea, right? So in clinical conditions like pulmonary edema, the individual can have sudden onset dyspnea. Next, you take in clinical conditions like ARDS, the individual can have sudden onset dyspnea. But here, if you see the question, the individual is having sudden onset, respiratory distress after the inserting a central venous catheter. So the answer here will be the pneumothorax. Remember, as such in case of COPD and as well as bronchial asthma, the individual may not have the sudden onset dyspnea. Whenever there is an acute exacerbation of that particular clinical condition, there they can have the sudden onset dyspnea. Alright, next. Now you see one more question. All of the following are the characteristic features of the primary spontaneous pneumothorax except. First option, male gender. Second option, old age. Third option, tall stature. Fourth option, history of smoking. Now, you take the, what did we discuss, the development of primary spontaneous pneumothorax? We have seen that primary spontaneous pneumothorax is seen in case of tall, thin, male smokers. But remember, it is not the old age. Right? It is not the old age. So, the answer here is old age. So, old age, they need not have this particular primary spontaneous pneumothorax. Now, after having discussing about the etiology, now let me discuss the clinical features in these patients with the pneumothorax. Right? Let me discuss the clinical features in these patients with the pneumothorax. So, if you see the clinical features here, right, if you see the clinical features here, first and foremost, there is a collapse of the lung. So, because of the collapse of the lung, the individual can develop a sudden onset dyspnea. Right, the individual can develop a sudden onset dyspnea. Okay, next. Apart from this particular sudden onset dyspnea, the individual will have a pleuritic chest pain. Right, the individual will have a pleuritic type of chest pain. Alright, next. Now, if you take on examination, what will be the findings? Remember, on examination, the patient will prefer to lie on the affected side. Right, the patient will prefer to lie on the affected side. I'll tell you why. Why? Because, right, why? Because, for example, you take the individual is having left-sided pneumothorax. If he lies on the left side, then there will be an adequate space for the right lung to get expanded. Now, if he lies on the opposite side, for example, he has left-sided pneumothorax and he is lying down on the right side. What will happen? Already left-sided lung is collapsed. And when he is lying on the right side, the right lung is also being compressed against the ground on which he is lying down. And that will further accentuate the asthma, that will further accentuate the difficulty in breathing or dyspnea in the individual. Okay. So, whenever the patient will try to lie on the affected side, at least the opposite lung will have an adequate space for the expansion. And that is the reason why the patient will prefer to lie on the affected side. Next. Apart from this, on examination, you will notice that there is tachycardia, there is increase in the heart rate of the individual. And not only that, you will notice there is also tachypnea, that there is increase in the respiratory rate. Now, you observe on inspection, the lung is collapsed. So, on whichever side the lung is being collapsed, the respiratory movements are reduced. So, respiratory movements are reduced in this individual. Now, coming to the trachea, what will happen to the trachea? Never go under an impression that the lung is collapsed, that is the reason why trachea will be shifted to the same side. No. There is large quantity of air within the pleural space, which is giving a positive pressure. So that in pneumothorax, the positive pressure which is there within the pleural space will shift the mediastinum to the opposite side. So even the trachea is also shifted to the opposite side. So if you take the mediastinum, it is being shifted to the opposite side. Okay, next. Now, you take the tactile vocal phrenitis or tactile phrenitis. What will happen to the tactile phrenitis? The tactile phrenitis is reduced. Why? Because lung itself is not there. Lung is collapsed. Where is the question of the generation of the vibrations within the lung parenchyma? No. Right? So, because the lung is collapsed, the tactile phrenitis is also reduced. Okay, next. You take on percussion. Remember, on percussion, because of the presence of large quantity of the air within the lung fields, in the sense, over the thorax, there is presence of what is called as the hyper-resonant node. Right, there is presence of what is called as the hyper-resonant node. Okay, right, this is a very, very important point that you should remember. There is presence of the hyper-resonant node. You take a normal lung fields, the resonant node. Whereas in case of pneumothorax, you have the hyper-resonant node. Next, the other thing is, you see over the, in auscultation, lung is completely not there. The lung is collapsed. So you will have absent breath sounds. So lung is not there here. So on auscultation, the breath sounds are completely absent. So remember, you take the breath sounds in these individuals. Breath sounds, they are absent. So what will happen to your vocal fremitus? Remember, the vocal fremitus is similar to that of your tactile fremitus. So even your lung is being collapsed. So that is the reason why the vocal fremitus is reduced or absent. So this will be the examination findings apart from this. Right, apart from this, there are some more findings in these patients with the pneumothorax. Let me tell you here. You take the, for example, if the individual is having right-sided pneumothorax, what will happen? This particular right-sided pneumothorax, that is the air which is present in the pleural space, can obliterate the liver dullness. Where will you feel for the liver dullness on percussion? Remember, we will feel for the liver dullness in the fifth right intercostal space. Now, because of the presence of the pneumothorax, that is, the presence of the air which is present in the pleural space will obliterate the, or will cover the liver. That is the reason why you will not be able to feel the liver dullness if the individual is having a right-sided pneumothorax. So remember, there is obliteration of, right, obliteration of the liver dullness. Right, in case of the right-sided pneumothorax. Right, in case of right-sided pneumothorax. Next. Now, there is another an important sign which is called as the Hamann sign. Now, let me tell you what you mean by this particular Hamann sign. Right, what do you mean by this particular Hamann sign? Right, in case of Hamann sign, where do you get this Hamann sign is the question first. You get this Hamann sign in conditions of mediastinal emphysema. Right, in case of mediastinal emphysema. Now, what is this mediastinal emphysema? Remember, there is an accumulation of a pocket of air. Right, there is an accumulation of a pocket of air within the mediastinum. That is what is called as the mediastinal emphysema. Now, what is another important vital structure in the mediastinum? That is heart. Whenever the heart is undergoing contraction and relaxation, that is when the heart is undergoing systole and as well as diastole, the heart will touch, or it can touch this particular mediastinal emphysema, right? And these patients with the mediastinal emphysema, they can develop what is called as the left-sided pneumothorax. Right? They can develop what is called as the left-sided pneumothorax. Now, the question is, what is this Hamann sign? Now, the heart which is present within the mediastinum can touch the mediastinal emphysema, that is the pocket of air, whenever it is undergoing contraction and relaxation. So, whenever the heart comes in contact with this particular mediastinal emphysema at a zone, you will be able to listen the crunching sound. That particular crunching sound what you listen is what is called as the Hamann sign. So, remember, the other important, that is the Hamann sign, it is the crunching sound which is synchronous with the heartbeat. Right, which is synchronous with the heartbeat. So that is what is called as the Hamann sign. Right, that is what is called as the Hamann sign. Now let me show you a question here. Now before that, okay. Right, before that, let me tell you, how do you diagnose? So these are your clinical features. Right, these are your clinical features in patients with the pneumothorax, the clinical features and as well as the examination findings. Now, see, we have classified the pneumothorax depending upon what is the etiology of the pneumothorax, that is traumatic pneumothorax and spontaneous pneumothorax. And we can also classify the pneumothorax depending upon its anatomy, that is we have what is called as closed pneumothorax. Right, we have what is called as the closed pneumothorax. Now, what do you mean by this word closed pneumothorax is? Remember, in case of the closed pneumothorax, it is only a small pocket of air which will be accumulated within the pleural space. And that will result in what is called as the closed pneumothorax. So, closed pneumothorax is a pocket of air which is present in the pleural space. That is what is called as closed pneumothorax. Remember, you don't require any treatment for the closed pneumothorax. This will undergo spontaneous resolution. Right? This will undergo spontaneous resolution. Now, the dangerous pneumothorax, what we are very much worried is about what is called as the tension pneumothorax. Right? Is called as the tension pneumothorax. So, if you see this particular tension pneumothorax, what exactly will happen? Let me discuss. Right? If you take this tension pneumothorax, what will happen? Let me discuss. In case of tension pneumothorax, now let me show you an image over here. So, consider this is the lung field wherein you have the parietal pleura and as well as the visceral pleura as well. Now, we will imagine that the pleura has ruptured in the form of a flap. Right? The pleura has ruptured in the form of a flap. Now, what will happen in these patients with the tension pneumothorax is, whenever the individual is inhaling, the air enters into the lung parenchyma and this particular air will enter into the pleural space. Right? This particular air will enter into the pleural space. And whenever the individual is exhaling, this particular flap will be covered. Right? This particular flap will be covered over the ruptured pleura whenever the individual is exhaling. Right, whenever the individual is exhaling. So, remember, during inhalation, the flap opens, the air enters into the pleural space. During exhalation, the flap will cover the ruptured pleura. That means what is happening? With every inspiration, right, with every inspiration, there is continuous accumulation of air. Right, there is continuous accumulation of air within the pleural space. Okay, there is continuous accumulation of the air within the pleural space. That means as the time is progressing, the positive pressure within the pleura is increasing with every cycle of respiration. So, that will lead to complete collapse of the lung. Right, that will lead to complete collapse of the lung. So, now in these particular patients with the tension pneumothorax, when you auscultate, you get a classical bronchial breathing. And that particular bronchial breathing, what you get in these patients with the tension pneumothorax, this is called as amphoric breath sounds. Right, this is called as amphoric breath sounds. Amphoric breath sounds are those particular breath sounds where you have metallic quality. Right, where you have metallic quality. See, bronchial breath sounds, there are totally of three types: tubular bronchial breathing, cavernous bronchial breathing, and amphoric breath sounds. Right? Amphoric bronchial breathing. Now, tubular bronchial breathing, you listen over the patient with a consolidation, secondary to pneumonia. Cavernous breath sounds, you listen over a cavity. And the amphoric breath sounds, you listen in case of tension pneumothorax, which is of metallic quality. Alright? Next. Remember, another very important point here. These individuals with the tension pneumothorax is a medical emergency. What will you do is a question. Okay, you see this question here. We have a 30-year-old female comes with acute breathlessness. Neck veins are distended. There is absent breath sounds and mediastinum is shifted. Which of the following should be done immediately? Do you want to do HRCT like it is the investigation of choice is the first option? ABJ analysis should be done is the second option. Third option is the chest X-ray. Fourth option is large bore needle puncture of the pleura. Now, what will you do here? Now, the patient lung is getting collapsed. The individual is having severe respiratory distress and the patient is having a respiratory failure as well, and due to which the individual may even have an arrest. So now in this particular patient, subjecting the patient to further investigation will be useless, right? We have a clinical data, very easy. The patient is having acute breathlessness. That means sudden onset SOB. And neck veins are distended, right? So why do you think the neck veins are distended? Only and only whenever there is increase in the intrathoracic pressure, the neck veins will be distended. And you take the breath sounds are absent and mediastinum being shifted opposite side. All these are the features suggestive of that the patient is having pneumothorax. So whenever there is, you are confirmed that the patient is having pneumothorax, don't wait for your x-ray or don't wait for your HRCT. Take a wide bore needle and puncture the pleura. So once you take a wide bore needle and puncture the pleura, then what you are able to do is you are able to release the pressure over the lung parenchyma, and the collapsed lung parenchyma will expand. So the answer here is B. Large bore needle puncture of the pleura. Is that clear? Now let me discuss how do you investigate these patients with the pneumothorax. One is based on the clinical finding and the other one is the chest x-ray. Right? The other one is the chest x-ray. Right? So you see this particular chest x-ray of the patient. So on which side do you think that there is the pneumothorax? Remember, it is not on the left side you have pneumothorax. It is on the right side where you have the pneumothorax. Right? It is on the right side where you have the pneumothorax. So you will be able to appreciate there is hyperlucent lung fields. So these are all your hyperlucent lung fields. Right? These are all your hyperlucent lung fields. That is one important finding. And the second thing is you will be able to make out the pleura and the lung collapse. So you see here. Right, this is the pleura, that is visceral pleura, and this is your all, the collapsed lung. And the other important finding is the absence of the bronchovascular markings. Now you see, in this particular x-ray, on the left side, you will be able to make out the bronchovascular markings. Whereas here, the bronchovascular markings are absent. So, if you take the x-ray picture in patients with the pneumothorax, number one, there will be presence of hyperlucency. Right? Next, the other thing is absence of bronchovascular markings. Right? Absence of bronchovascular markings. And the other one is the mediastinum. Right? Mediastinum being shifted to the opposite side. Right? Mediastinum being shifted to the opposite side. So these are the important features in patients with the pneumothorax. Okay, so this is the chest x-ray picture in patients with the pneumothorax. Now, let me move on to the treatment of these patients with the pneumothorax. So regarding the treatment, I'll just show you a question here. So this is another chest x-ray which is showing that the patient is having pneumothorax. So you can observe that in this patients with the pneumothorax, there is absent bronchovascular markings, there is hyperlucency. And you are able to make out this particular, the pleural line, that is the visceral pleura. And this is your collapsed lung and the trachea being shifted to the opposite side. Right. Yes. So this is the question. Which of the following statements about pneumothorax is true? Breath sounds are increased. Percussion note is decreased. Always needs chest tube insertion. Often needs chest tube insertion. This is the question. Now, remember, if you see the treatment in these individuals with the pneumothorax, the treatment in patients with the pneumothorax completely depends upon the CVRT of the pneumothorax. So, let me discuss that. So, if you see the treatment in these individuals, for example, if the individual is having small primary pneumothorax, right, if the individual is having small primary pneumothorax. If the individual is having small primary pneumothorax, don't do anything. It will undergo natural resolution. So remember, natural resolution will occur if the individual is having small primary pneumothorax. Now, if the individual is having large pneumothorax, and along with that, the individual is having dyspnea. And this is the point when you should not wait for anything. You need to do aspiration. right? You need to do aspiration, right? Next. For example, if the individual is having recurrent pneumothorax, right? The individual is having recurrent pneumothorax. In such case, you have to do pleurodesis, right? And this particular pleurodesis, you can do with talc or you can do with doxycycline. These are all the substances which can be used for pleurodesis. Now, I forgot to tell you, in case of large pneumothorax associated with the dyspnea, along with aspiration, following the aspiration, you need to put the intercostal drain. Right? Intercostal drain. Okay? Next. Now, for example, if the individual is having the more problematic pneumothorax, the recurrence rate is very high, right? And there is also failed ICD, right? Failed ICD. In such case, what you need to do is, if the pleurodesis, if it is effective in the individual, well and fine. If the pleurodesis is also not being effective, then you need to do what is called as a limited pleurectomy. Right, you need to do what is called limited pleurectomy. So, this is what you need to do in patients with the pneumothorax depending upon the severity of the pneumothorax. Alright, next. Now, let me show you the ICD over here. Yes, so this is the intercostal drain where you need to put the tube into the chest, that is into the pleural space, and the other side you need to put over the underwater seal. So, if the air column, right, or if the air is still present, then you will be able to notice the bubbles within the underwater, right? So, on the other side of the tube, you need to put over the bottle which is containing water. So, if the air is there, you will be able to observe that there is presence of the bubbles within the air, I mean, the bubbles within the water. And if the bubbles disappear, then it tells that the pneumothorax has been completely resolved, and that is the point when you can remove the intercostal drain. But you see the question here. Which of the following statements about pneumothorax is true? Breath sounds are increased, percussion note is decreased, always needs chest tube insertion, often needs chest tube insertion. Remember, it is not always needs chest tube insertion, right? It is only just often needs chest tube insertion. What did we discuss about the breath sounds? The breath sounds are absent in patients with the pneumothorax. And what did we discuss about the percussion note? The percussion note is increased. There will be hyper-resonant note in these patients with the pneumothorax. So, this completes the discussion on the pneumothorax.